Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grand Old Unraveling, The Republican Party, Donald Trump, and the Rise of Authoritarianism by John Kenneth White. Narrated by Bob Johnson. What's Past is Prologue. William Shakespeare, The Tempest. Preface, The Gathering Storm. There are some things that you just can't imagine happening in your life. This is one of them. Mitt Romney accepting Donald Trump's endorsement, February 2, 2012. On February 2, 2012, Mitt Romney and his wife, Ann, mounted the stage at an opulent gold-plated Las Vegas hotel to accept a political endorsement. Unlike other routine testimonials, this one was different. The person making the endorsement was a controversial celebrity who had never held political office and had been, until recently, a member of the opposite party. Donald J. Trump calculated that the former Massachusetts governor was the likely 2012 Republican nominee, although as late as the day prior, many speculated that Trump would endorse Romney's erstwhile opponent, former House Speaker Newt Gingrich. After all, Gingrich and Trump had much in common. Both had reputations for being rhetorical bomb throwers, were subjects of messy divorces, and shared a mutual contempt for their Democratic opponents. But Trump coldly calculated that Romney was a winner, calling him tough, sharp, and smart. The event took place in a circus-like atmosphere at the Trump-owned hotel, something that would become commonplace for Donald Trump's future rallies. The Romneys, both devout Mormons who adhere to that religion's strict moral codes, were decidedly uncomfortable in Trump's presence, as Mitt Romney candidly admitted to reporters covering the event. There are some things that you just can't imagine happening in your life. This is one of them. Ann Romney was even more discomfited, and she hurried off the stage at the earliest possible moment. Then New York Times reporter Mark Leibovich described how the candidate's wife's cheeks grew increasingly red through Mr. Trump's remarks, and she appeared on the verge of either laughter or terror during the whole show. Democrats mocked the Trump endorsement, and the Democratic National Committee issued a statement claiming both Romney and Trump enjoyed dismissing employees, citing Trump's signature line on the hit television show The Apprentice, "You're fired." John Lovett, a speechwriter for Barack Obama, tweeted, "I guess I'll take my lead from one of America's more garish and despicable figures." For many close observers of politics, the event became a subject of late-night laughs. David Letterman joked that Romney's decline in the polls was the inevitable after-effect of Trump's endorsement. But New York Times reporter Maggie Haberman recalled that Trump was energized by the event and wanted more appearances with Romney, a request the campaign rejected. Months earlier, Trump had regretfully announced that he would not seek the presidency, even as he boasted, "My potential candidacy continues to be validated by my ranking at the top of the Republican contenders in polls across the country." Days after Romney's loss to Barack Obama, Trump trademarked what would become his campaign slogan, "Make America Great Again," and his 2016 campaign for the Republican nomination began to unfold. A decade after Romney received this endorsement, after the tumultuous events of the Trump presidency, two impeachments, and an attempted coup, no one is laughing. Mitt Romney's discomfiture turned into scorn when he delivered a stinging rebuke of Trump in 2016, calling him a con man, a fake, and dismissively concluded, "Dishonesty is Donald Trump's hallmark." Democrats were in disbelief when Trump astonished the political world by beating Hillary Clinton, and few were amused when Trump cast aside accepted presidential norms of behavior, or when he was twice impeached, or when the U.S. Capitol was invaded by an angry mob on January 6, 2021. Even now, the threats to our democracy, which many believed would subside after Trump's 2020 defeat, remain. In 2022, nearly 300 Republican nominees for offices with the power to certify future elections either questioned the results of the 2020 election or believed the election was stolen. While many lost, Donald Trump continues to exercise unparalleled power within his own party, even as he is subjected to numerous criminal investigations and indictments. As this is written, Donald J. Trump is the leading contender to win the Republican nod in 2024, something only the defeated Richard M. Nixon achieved in the last 55 years. And Nixon's narrow victory in 1968 was due to the extraordinary circumstances of an unpopular war abroad and racial unrest at home. How did we get here? Some believe that an exhausted conservative agenda that was once revived by Ronald Reagan in 1980 had reached its natural death. Much of what Reagan did as president, enacting tax cuts, slowing the growth rate of federal spending, eliminating government regulations, and positioning the United States to defeat the Soviet Union, a country Reagan derisively referred to as the evil empire, now occupied dog-eared pages in dusty history books. The shop-worn question asked by admirers of the late president, "What would Reagan do?" was no longer relevant. By 2020, the paucity of conservative ideas was such that the grand old party, for the first time in its history, did not write a platform. The emerging issues of climate change, growing economic inequality, and post-Cold War overseas challenges have substantially altered the domestic political agenda. While Americans still distrust government, and younger citizens hardly know a time when government worked effectively, when faced with a pandemic, most people wanted government to do more. Joe Biden ascended to the presidency, determined to make government work again. At the same time, the Reagan coalition, evangelical, white, married, middle class, and suburban, was eroding thanks to a multiracial, less religiously affiliated country whose younger voters cast ballots in even larger numbers for Democratic candidates. The white middle-class suburban Republican majority that gave Dwight D. Eisenhower, Richard M. Nixon, and Ronald Reagan historic landslide victories could no longer deliver. Just as Democrats celebrated Franklin D. Roosevelt and the New Deal long after their expiration dates, in 2016, Republicans were still honoring a deceased president and a tiresome agenda. Donald Trump saw the vacuum and filled it. In 1844, Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote that in the United States, the conservative party, composed of the most moderate, able, and cultivated part of the population, is timid and merely defensive of property. It vindicates no right. It aspires to no real good. It brands no crime. It proposes no generous policy. It does not build, nor write, nor cherish the arts, nor foster religion, nor establish schools, nor encourage science, nor emancipate the slave, nor befriend the poor, or the Indian, or the immigrant. For Emerson, conservatives were a party of memory, enamored with the romanticism of the past and determined to preserve it. Liberals, said Emerson, had no such devotion, but instead were a party of hope. Freed from the constrictions of memory, they could inspire their followers to pursue new horizons and revolutionary beginnings. Emerson believed that while the best men were often found in a conservative movement, the best causes were those espoused by unshackled liberals. Political parties thrive when they embody both memory and hope. For Republicans, Ronald Reagan is the preeminent example of a successful politician who did both. Reagan summoned the happy memories of a prosperous and contented post-World War II era, a country bursting with energy, and an economic colossus whose city dwellers were boarding station wagons and moving into spanking new suburban homes. There was a boundless optimism that the 20th century would be, as Henry Luce predicted prior to the United States' entry into World War II, an American century. James Q. Wilson wrote the following description of Reagan country. Each family had a house. There it was for all to see and inspect. With a practiced glance, one could tell how much it cost, how well it was cared for, how good a lawn had been coaxed into uncertain life, and how tastefully plants and shrubs had been set out. These Sunday drive picture postcards became centerpieces for Reagan's consistent recitation of the homespun values embodied in family, work, neighborhood, peace, and freedom. But Reagan's appeal to a pleasantly remembered past was also accompanied by a firm belief that the future remained hopeful. Even after having been diagnosed with the Alzheimer's disease that would claim his life, Reagan issued a final farewell, ending with these words, "I know that for America there will always be a bright dawn ahead." But Emerson saw danger when parties became subject to the bidding of unprincipled leaders who reaped the rewards of the docility and zeal of the masses, which they direct. Inevitably, Emerson believed, parties of principle degenerate into personalities, which become a source of danger. By 2020, both major parties were animated by neither memory nor hope, but by fear. Most Republicans believe the memories they cherish can no longer be preserved. Emerson himself forecast that, with fading memories, conservatives had an instinctive proclivity to see society as sick, taking as low a view of every part of human action and passion. Today, it is this sickness, as Emerson predicted, that has got into the ballot box that Donald Trump and his progenitors so skillfully exploit. John Daniel Davidson writes that the animating values of individual rights, family values, and religious freedom have been lost to an ascendant left that has transformed America into a woke dystopia. This includes a redefinition of marriage, the First Amendment, any semblance of control over our borders, the fundamental distinction between men and women, and, especially of late, the basic rule of law. For Davidson, only two paths remain: awake from decades of slumber to reclaim and refound what has been lost, or watch our civilization die. It is this fear that all is lost, and that Republicans must use whatever means necessary to avoid being relegated to permanent minority status, or even political oblivion, that has prompted party-led efforts to suppress the vote and contest elections they did not win. In 1980, conservative Paul Weyrich told a gathering of evangelicals, "Our leverage in the elections goes up as the voting populace goes down." 6 years later, a ballot integrity initiative underwritten by the Republican National Committee tried to expunge an estimated 60 to 80,000 names from the voting rolls. An internal party memo stated that, if successful, the program would keep the black vote down considerably. In 1994, California Republican Michael Huffington refused to concede his U.S. Senate loss to Democrat Dianne Feinstein, citing overwhelming evidence of illegal ballots cast by undocumented immigrants. A Feinstein spokesperson denounced Huffington as a spoiled rich kid and a sour grapes loser. Only months later did Huffington issue a concession statement. In 1996, House Speaker Newt Gingrich charged, "We now have proof that a close congressional contest won by a Democrat was stolen thanks to a sufficient number of non-citizens voting." That same year, the Senate Rules Committee voted unanimously to accept the results of the Louisiana State Senate election that gave Democrat Mary Landrieu another 6-year term. Landrieu's opponent, Woody Jenkins, marketed brightly colored socks reading, "Don't get cold feet, sock it to voter fraud." But Jenkins's case collapsed when witnesses were allegedly schooled as to how they could invent stories of voter fraud. Eventually, 4 of Jenkins's 6 witnesses recanted their testimony. In 2000, Florida Republicans spurred an effort to purge thousands from the state's voter rolls, nearly all Democrats and half of them African American. David Basaitis, a senior research associate at the Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies, concluded that the effort led by Republican Governor Jeb Bush and Secretary of State Katherine Harris was a patently obvious technique to discriminate against black voters. The program proved vitally important in securing the presidency for Bush's brother, George, when Harris certified his wafer-thin 537-vote victory over Al Gore in a state that decided the election. 22 years later, Florida Republican Governor Ron DeSantis created the Office of Election Crimes and Security and ordered the arrests of those with prior felony convictions who were issued voting cards. Making the announcement, DeSantis said, "They're going to pay the price." Those arrested faced up to 5 years in jail and a $5,000 fine. The arresting officers confessed that they had never encountered similar warrants. When did the Republican Party begin its transformation into a Trump-dominated party that many of its former members hardly recognize? Some believe it began in 1964 with the rise of Barry Goldwater and his rejection of Me Too New Dealism and his tacit embrace of the John Birch Society. Others cite Richard Nixon's embrace of the Southern Strategy in 1968, whose coded language transformed the party's historic commitment to civil rights into a largely white-dominated party that would find a home in the once democratic South. Others believe it began with the ascent of Newt Gingrich to the House speakership. Gingrich's rise coincided with his use of loaded speech and the frustration of his fellow Republicans at the party's go-along, get-along approach to Democratic congressional leaders. In a 1990 memo titled Language, a Key Mechanism of Control, Gingrich advised Republicans to use words such as destructive, liberal, welfare, traitors, radical, anti-child, and corruption when describing their opponents, saying, "You're fighting a war. It is a war for power." Former Democratic Congressman Barney Frank recalled that Gingrich transformed American politics from one in which people presumed the goodwill of their opponents, even as they disagreed, into one in which people treated the people with whom they disagreed as bad and immoral. He was a kind of McCarthyite who succeeded. Thanks to a combination of Newt speak and the party's frustration with continually losing control of the House, Gingrich was Republicans' inevitable choice to assume the speakership in 1995. Gingrich once told his staff that his primary purpose in politics was not to legislate or win re-election, but to save Western civilization. In his book, The Deconstructionists, the 25-year crack-up of the Republican Party, Dana Milbank describes how the Republican Party, under Gingrich's leadership, morphed into its present-day form. Attacking political opponents and government bureaucrats during his presidency, Donald Trump employed his own version of Newt speak, labeling them as bad, dirty, horrible, evil, sick, corrupt, lowlifes, and the crookedest, most dishonest, dirtiest people I've ever seen. But a longer view shows that for several decades, the Republican Party contained the strands of Trump-like anti-democratic thinking that are now fully manifest. Those origins began with the five successive defeats of Republican presidential candidates, starting with Herbert Hoover's landslide loss in 1932 and ending with Thomas E. Dewey's surprising defeat in 1948. A close look at these contests reveal a frustrated party that latched onto conspiracy theories of foreign involvement that covertly assisted the Democrats, to nefarious actions by Democratic officials, to questioning whether ballots were properly counted, to blaming voters who were dependent on federal government programs for their losses. Even when Republicans won the presidency, the party establishment became so obsessed with winning that little was done to strengthen the party organization. Beginning with Dwight Eisenhower, Republican presidents treated the party as a kind of Hertz rent-a-car, used only for the purpose of gaining universal ballot access while building their own personal apparatuses, whose loyalties were to a single individual. For many Republicans, the joys of winning meant embracing a personal presidency whose occupants would float above the party, yet dominated, a phenomenon that would quickly envelop the Democrats. As one House Republican remarked after signing a petition challenging the 2020 election results, "The things we do for the Orange Jesus." Some listeners may wonder whether I have overlooked abuses of power employed by past Democratic presidents, including Woodrow Wilson's 1920 Red Scare campaign, Franklin D. Roosevelt's 1942 internment order imprisoning Japanese U.S. citizens, Internal Revenue Service audits of prominent Republicans conducted by Democratic administrations, the electronic surveillance and harassment of Martin Luther King under the auspices of the Kennedy administration, and Lyndon B. Johnson's bugging of Barry Goldwater's 1964 presidential campaign, to name but a few. These abuses have been well cataloged. But there is a qualitative difference between these abuses of power and a Republican Party under the domination of a single flawed individual who poses a threat to our democracy. That threat became crystal clear on January 6, 2021, when a mob incited by Donald Trump invaded the U.S. Capitol, waved a Confederate flag, and sought to overturn a presidential election. Their aim was to stop the peaceful transfer of power, an extra-constitutional right established with Thomas Jefferson's peaceful transition into the presidency in 1801. Not even during the Civil War had the Capitol been invaded and political violence ensued, including the deaths of 5 police officers and hundreds of others with life-changing injuries. The delirious, angry rioters were convinced that the 2020 election had been stolen and saw Donald Trump's impending defeat as a political Armageddon, one that must be averted at all costs. Ashley Babbitt, an insurrectionist cloaked in a Trump campaign flag, posted these final words the day before she was killed by a Capitol Police officer as she attempted to enter the House of Representatives, whose members had donned gas masks, cowered under seats, and barricaded the doors. "The storm is here, and it is descending on D.C. in 24 hours. Babbitt was an Air Force veteran who had voted for Barack Obama, but became a QAnon believer and died in the service of Donald Trump. In 1861, faced with another insurrection, Abraham Lincoln told Congress that the Civil War was a war upon the first principle of popular government, the rights of the people. Any abridgment of the existing right of suffrage, Lincoln said, is the source of all political evil, concluding, "In my present position, I could scarcely be justified were I to admit raising a warning voice against this approach of returning despotism." Lincoln's admonition is, once again, especially pertinent. In the aftermath of the Capitol insurrection, 2/3 of Americans believed the divisions within the country had worsened, and 3 in 5 anticipated an increase in political violence in the coming years. An astonishing 43% predicted another civil war was either very likely or somewhat likely, with 53% of Trump voters sharing this view. After the FBI conducted a search warrant on Trump's Mar-a-Lago property, the former president posted online that the 2020 election was irreparably compromised and a minimal solution would be to have a new election immediately. Far from tamping down the emotions of his followers, Donald Trump continues to incite their anger and anxieties. Memory and hope have given way to fear and rage. For decades, I have studied and written about the Republican Party, beginning with The Fractured Electorate, a look at the GOP in 3 southern New England states, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, and Connecticut, to the new politics of old values, which traced the rise of Ronald Reagan and how his emphasis on the values of family, work, neighborhood, peace, and freedom resonated with voters, to the values divide, which saw the beginnings of a partisan chasm where an emphasis on values spurred by pleasant memories of the past was giving way to a culture war that Republicans feared losing, to still seeing red, which examined the creation of a Cold War party system that propelled the Republican Party into the presidency, to what happened to the Republican Party, which traced the challenges the party faced after failing to win the popular vote in every election from 1992 to 2012, with the sole exception of George W. Bush's victory in 2004. These works, as well as the history of the Republican Party since the 1930s, read differently today in light of Donald Trump's presidency and its tumultuous aftermath. As historian Matthew Dalek notes, the radicalization of the Republican Party was contingent, halting, and gradual, not foreordinated and inevitable. Yet, from rereading that history, the anti-democratic strains within today's Republican Party trace their antecedents to events that occurred decades earlier. In his aptly titled memoir, The Gathering Storm, which chronicles the events leading up to and including World War II, Winston Churchill wrote that it was his purpose to demonstrate that the war was enabled by the malice of the wicked and was reinforced by the weakness of the virtuous. Churchill concluded that the structure and habits of democratic states, unless they are welded into larger organisms, lack those elements of persistence and conviction which can alone give security to humble masses. It is this fight between malice and virtue, between hope and fear, between memory and rage, that threatens the underpinnings of our democracy. Summoning the ghost of Abraham Lincoln, Representative Jamie Raskin noted that our constitutional democracy is the silver frame upon which the golden apple of freedom rests. That frame still holds, but its foundations are weakened. Unless democracy is vigorously and continuously defended, historian Timothy Snyder warns, we're looking almost certainly at an attempt by the Republicans in 2024 to take power without winning the election. Unless we heed the lessons taught by Winston Churchill and the wisdom of Abraham Lincoln, democracy will continue to hang in the balance. Introduction: Passions and Interests. Republicans shatter a delicate balance. No democracy without parties. Clinton Rossiter, Parties and Politics in America. On January 7, 2005, an unusual event took place at a joint session of Congress called to certify the results of the previous presidential election. For the first time in 128 years, the normally placid proceeding was interrupted when the certified electoral votes from Ohio were officially challenged. Objecting were Democratic Congresswoman Stephanie Tubb Jones and Democratic Senator Barbara Boxer. The state's official count gave George W. Bush a 118,601 plurality over John F. Kerry, a clear victory. But Democrats charged that voter irregularities provided Bush with the win. In Lake County, Ohio, a handful of voters reported receiving flyers claiming they were ineligible to vote. As the charges of fraud intensified, the county's elections commissioner said, "I have had an election year I'd never thought I'd experience in my 21 years. I've had to do so much damage control." After Bush declared victory the morning after Election Day, conspiracy theories abounded that Ohio's voting machines had inexplicably switched votes from Kerry to Bush. Rising from her seat in the House chamber, Boxer argued that Congress had a responsibility to cast the light of truth on a flawed system which must be fixed now. Republicans howled in protest. House Majority Whip Tom DeLay lamented the Democratic quadrennial crying of wolf, asserting that any fraud charges were Hollywood-inspired. The supposedly wronged Democrat, John Kerry, was not even present as he was abroad visiting U.S. troops. After a two-hour debate, Democrats conceded defeat, and the drama ended. But Republicans remained aggrieved, with Senator Rick Santorum calling time spent on the issue a travesty and declaring that Democrats were not over the 2000 election, let alone the 2004 election. Santorum had a point. Reflecting on her objection, Boxer admitted she had made a mistake in not objecting to the outcome of the Bush versus Gore race 4 years earlier. The hard feelings many Democrats had about the George W. Bush presidency stemmed from accumulated resentments after the contentious Bush versus Gore contest. The controversial Florida vote, officially certified by the Republican Secretary of State as giving Bush a 537-vote win and the presidency, was upheld by a 5-4 decision of the Supreme Court. Conceding defeat after 36 days of recounts and court battles, Al Gore declared, "We will stand together behind our new president." Gore cited Stephen Douglas, who, after losing the presidency to Abraham Lincoln in 1860, proclaimed that partisan feeling must yield to patriotism, adding that the strength of American democracy is shown most clearly through the difficulties it can overcome. Gore promised to do everything possible to bring Americans together in fulfillment of the great vision that our Declaration of Independence defines and that our Constitution affirms and demands. His gracious concession gave Bush the needed legitimacy to begin his administration. Democracy had endured. But during the 36 days before the Supreme Court decision ended the 2000 election, Democrats and Republicans accused each other of subverting democracy. Given that Florida's electoral votes would determine the next president, partisan feeling swelled as Democrats and Republicans swarmed county clerk offices and battled one another in courts. Democrats argued that votes should be accurately counted, while Republicans contended for the rule of law. Gore's campaign chief, William Daley, declared, "If the will of the people is to prevail, Al Gore should be awarded a victory in Florida and be our next president." But the Wall Street Journal countered that if nefarious Democrats engineered a Gore victory thanks to a friendly judge, the United States would be transformed into a banana republic, with Gore seizing power thanks to a coup d'etat. The Weekly Standard, an influential journal of conservative Republican thinking, claimed that the central processes of our democracy were being upended by the fanatic ambition of a single demagogue. When the time came for Congress to officially certify the results, several House Democrats rose to challenge the Florida count. Eddie Bernice Johnson claimed to have overwhelming evidence that George W. Bush did not win this election, either by the national popular vote or the Florida popular vote. With her outraged Democratic colleagues shouting fraud and disenfranchisement, Johnson said that if Bush was declared the winner, he should be on notice that without justice, there will be no peace. But each time a House Democrat rose to object, senators remained seated. Without a senator joining the House Democrats' objections, the presiding officer, Vice President Al Gore, ruled the challenges out of order. After the contentious ceremony ended, Gore stood and declared, "May God bless our new president and our new vice president, and may God bless the United States of America." The defeated Democrat then left the Capitol to cheers and applause. Once more, democracy had endured another stress test. A third disputed election also reaffirmed the strength of American democracy and the vital role political parties have historically played in preserving it. In 1876, Democrat Samuel J. Tilden won the popular vote but lost the Electoral College after a congressional commission ruled that Rutherford B. Hayes won the controversial electoral votes cast in Florida, South Carolina, and Louisiana, thus keeping the presidency in Republican hands. Democrats were outraged. One Democrat decried the imbeciles who allowed the consummation of this wicked scheme. Another wanted Tilden to call upon your party to immediately inaugurate you, promising his fellow Democrats will swarm from every section of the country to carry out your wishes. A third promised that his fellow partisans would resist to the last extremity and until eternal justice prevails. Others advised Tilden to take his case to the Supreme Court. Right up to Inauguration Day, it was uncertain whether Hayes or Tilden would take the presidential oath. Barring any final challenge, it was Hayes who said the magic words mandated by the Constitution to become president, doing so privately on March 4, 1877, since it was a Sunday. A public ceremony followed the next day. In his inaugural address, Hayes cited the extraordinary circumstances surrounding the election, noting that for the first time, an enlightened tribunal appointed by Congress had certified the outcome. Hayes conceded that opinion will widely vary as to the wisdom of the several conclusions announced by that tribunal, but added the fact that two great political parties have in this way settled a dispute in regard to which good men differ as to the facts and the law, no less than as to the proper course to be pursued in solving the question in controversy, is an occasion for general rejoicing. Hayes noted that in having settled their differences, both parties gave to the world the first example in history of a great nation hushing party tumults to yield the issue of the contest to adjustment according to the forms of law. Months later, Tilden officially conceded, saying, "If my voice could reach throughout our country and be heard in its remotest hamlet, I would say, be of good cheer. The Republic will live. The institutions of our fathers are not to expire in shame. The sovereignty of the people shall be rescued from this peril and be reestablished." Political parties, the essential instruments of democracy. Political scientist Harvey Mansfield captured the essence of the partisan disagreements surrounding these three disputed contests, writing, "The Republicans stand for the rule of law, and the Democrats for the rule of the people. and the Democrats, because they stand for the rule of the people, believe that rule should be paramount and the technicalities are subordinate to that will, whereas Republicans believe in doing things properly or legally. The contested elections of 1876, 2000, and 2004 were struggles involving these essential principles. Although sometimes conflicting, adherence to both the popular will and the rule of law is necessary to make democracy work. It is the essential role of parties to uphold both principles, even as they disagree as to which should be given the greater weight. Political scientists, therefore, have placed great value on the vitality of political parties, making them necessary concomitants to ensure democratic government. Since the founding of political science as a separate academic discipline at the turn of the 20th century, scholars have extolled the value of parties. At various moments, their praise has reached a crescendo with the advent of wars and the fall of authoritarian regimes. Both during and after World War II, political scientists loudly proclaimed the vital role parties play in ensuring free, democratic governance. Writing in 1942, E.E. Schottschneider declared, "It should be flatly stated that the political parties created democracy and that modern democracy is unthinkable save in terms of parties." In 1960, Clinton Rossiter employed his own tautology that elegantly summarized the party's essential role. "No America without democracy, no democracy without politics, no politics without political parties." Rossiter likened the Democratic and Republican parties to vast, gaudy, friendly umbrellas under which all are invited for the sake of being counted in the next election. In 1964, V.O. Key Jr. wrote, "Political parties constitute a basic element of democratic institutional apparatus. They perform an essential function in the management of succession to power, as well as in the process of obtaining popular consent to the course of public policy. They amass sufficient support to buttress the authority of governments, or, on the contrary, they attract or organize discontent and dissatisfaction sufficient to oust the government. In either case, they perform the function of the articulation of the interests and aspirations of a substantial segment of the citizenry, usually in ways contended to be promotive of the national weal." Another influential political scientist, Maurice Duverger, agreed with Key, stating, "On the whole, the development of parties seems bound up with that of democracy, that is to say, with the extension of popular suffrage and parliamentary prerogatives." Decades later, Gerald Pomper succinctly made his case for vibrant political parties. "We must either acknowledge the mutual reliance of our parties and democracy, or lose both." The fall of the Soviet Union only strengthened the Academy's belief that, according to Pomper, "freedom requires political parties seeking power in fair and open elections." For Pomper and his colleagues, establishing flourishing democracies in the former Soviet Union and Eastern Europe depended on whether the contending parties could popularly contest elections and accept those outcomes. Political scientists understood that parties provided more than structure and form to contest elections. Ideological commitments made political parties into something more than the dispassionate, rational entities envisioned by Anthony Downs, whose only purpose is to garner enough votes to obtain power. Notably, it was a political scientist, Woodrow Wilson, who saw his election to the presidency in 1912 as more than a personal victory, asserting that voters had commandeered the Democratic Party to make changes in governance. In his 1913 inaugural address, Wilson declared, "The success of a party means little except when the nation is using that party for a large and definite purpose. No one can mistake the purpose for which the nation now seeks to use the Democratic Party. It seeks to use it to interpret a change in its own plans and point of view. Our duty is to cleanse, to reconsider, to restore, to correct the evil without impairing the good, to purify and humanize every aspect of our common life without weakening or sentimentalizing it." Another president, Martin Van Buren, held a similar view. It has always struck me as more honorable and manly and more in harmony with the character of our people and our institutions to deal with the subject of political parties in a sincerer and wiser spirit, to recognize their necessity, to give them the credit they deserve, and to devote ourselves to improve and to elevate the principles and objects of our own and to support it ingenuously and faithfully. Gerald Pomper writes that a party without an ideology is akin to a party without a soul. Contemporary parties require an ideological purpose if they are to gain support. They must save their souls if they would win the world of power. At the same time, the search for salvation by an ideological community can distort the parties as instruments of electoral politics. There is no moral profit for parties that save their souls but corrupt the world of democracy. Balancing passions and interests. Pomper's warning that ideological fervor could corrupt democracies captures the fears of the nation's founders who deployed factions as threats to liberty. In his famous Federalist 10 essay, James Madison defined factions as a number of citizens, whether amounting to a majority or minority of the whole, who are united and activated by some common impulse of passion or of interest adverse to the rights of other citizens or to the permanent and aggregate interests of the community. Madison conceded that citizens inevitably organized themselves into many contending groups. Thus, controlling the violence of faction meant corralling factions into the republican form of government that the Constitution envisioned. Eventually, however, Madison, together with Thomas Jefferson, formed what became the Democratic Party, even as Jefferson proclaimed, "If I could not go to heaven but with a party, I would not go there at all." In his own way, Madison agreed with Edmund Burke's definition of a political party as a body of men united for promoting by their joint endeavors the national interest upon some particular principle in which they are all agreed. Madison's warning about the dangerous vice of factions was foreshadowed by his antecedents. The French philosopher Voltaire wrote that a faction is a seditious party when it is still feeble, when it does not rejoin the entire state. But when factions in states are joined, they become despotic. Giovanni Sartori believed the word faction conveys an idea of hubris, of excessive, ruthless, and thereby harmful behavior. The English philosopher David Hume agreed, writing, "Factions subvert government, render laws impotent, and beget the fiercest animosities among men of the same nation." Sartori noted that when the heads of competing parties become intertwined with governing, the result is that parties both divide and share, their divisions centering around what Gerald Pomper called passions and interests, even while sharing the larger purpose of creating a central government given to compromise and obedience to the rule of law. For Hume, establishing inter-party harmony is the most agreeable prospect for future happiness. It was, however, this dissension and lack of happiness within his cabinet that prompted George Washington to issue his famous warning about the dangers posed by political parties in his farewell address. His speech, still read aloud on the floor of Congress, warned of the tendency of political parties to render alien to each other those who ought to be bound together by fraternal affection. Parties, he wrote, serve to organize faction, to give it an artificial and extraordinary force, to put in the place of the delegated will of the nation the will of a party, often a small but artful and enterprising minority of the community. Washington believed that, over time, parties would become potent engines by which cunning, ambitious, and unprincipled men will be enabled to subvert the power of the people and to usurp for themselves the reins of government, destroying afterwards the very engines which have lifted them to unjust dominion. Governed by ill-founded jealousies and false alarms, these animosities perpetrated the most horrid enormities, even the occasional riot and insurrection that causes the minds of men to seek security and repose in the absolute power of an individual. Thus, Washington concluded, the common and continual mischiefs of the spirit of party were responsible for the ruins of public liberty. Despite Washington's admonitions, parties are the inevitable result of a combination of voters' passions and interests. The French constitutional thinker Benjamin Constant wrote in 1815, "One cannot hope to exclude factions from a political organization where the advantages of liberty are wont to be preserved." For Constant, the inevitability of parties required continuous labor to render them as harmless as possible. In his masterpiece, The American Commonwealth, James Bryce wrote, "Parties are inevitable. No large country has been without them. No one has shown how representative government could be worked without them." Giovanni Sartori agreed, noting, "Parties came to be accepted, subconsciously and even so with formidable reluctance, with the realization that diversity and dissent are not necessarily incompatible with or disruptive of political order." By establishing rules and order, parties inherently confine conflict within certain bounds, with outcomes adhered to by all sides once either the voters or the courts have settled the matter. This truism held until 2021, when an outgoing president instigated an insurrection against both the rule of law and popular sovereignty itself. Upsetting the balance, the Trump movement, and the hollowing out of the Republican Party. Speaking before the Conservative Political Action Committee, CPAC, conference in March 2023, Donald Trump declared that his followers belong to a movement like has never been seen. I think we could probably say never been seen anywhere in the world. Historically, parties have been buffeted by movements like the Know-Nothings of the early 19th century, or the anti-slavery movement at that same century's midpoint, or the populists at its conclusion that transformed American politics yet subsumed their most passionate supporters into one of their major parties whose disparate elements serve to temper their demands. The pluralistic nature of American society has meant that shifting coalitions inevitably occurred both within the major parties and between them. As Sidney Taro notes in his book, Movements and Parties, these noisy participants have often been transformed by their encounters with parties, sometimes becoming what sociologists call institutionalized, and sometimes becoming parties themselves. Historically, political scientists have cited two distinct functions to each phenomenon. Movements articulate interests. Parties aggregate them. As Samuel Huntington has written, the function of the party is to organize participation, to aggregate interests, to serve as the link between social forces and the government. Movement success, says Taro, means combining both insider and outsider tactics, infusing new blood into a party while responding to others who want their demands translated into laws. At key moments, the intersections of movements and parties fulfilled Martin Luther King's aphorism that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Organized labor, the women's movement, and the civil rights movement garnered influence, particularly but not exclusively within the Democratic Party. Yet as they competed with other intra-party factions, their demands were tempered by the party's response. According to Taro, people who enter public life through movements veer into parties, and parties shift their ground to embrace new issues and attack the cleavages exposed by the conflict. For today's Democrats, movement politics involves demands based on race, gender, the environment, and sexual preference that have resulted in necessary compromises underwritten by the Democratic Party. Joe Biden's 2020 nomination illustrates this point. While Biden won overwhelming support from older black voters, especially women and centrist Democrats, Bernie Sanders, a self-proclaimed socialist and movement leader, was the overwhelming choice of young voters, liberals, gays, and environmentalists. Biden prudently joined forces with Sanders, and together they wrote the 2020 Democratic platform. What made the Trump movement possible and gave it such power was a long hollowing out of the Republican Party's establishment wing. As Taro notes, Republicans absorbed several ideological-driven right-wing movements, while a paucity of conservative thought gave the Trump movement an opportunity for a hostile takeover. The conditions that gave rise to Donald Trump were long in the making. Political scientist Wilson Carey McWilliams once compared parties to institutions of higher learning, claiming they were indispensable instruments in the school of citizenship. But over the years, the delicate balance between passions and interests became tilted in favor of passion. As McWilliams notes, fans of a particular political party have no serious bond of interest and are rooted in a feeling of being with certain people more than being for certain programs or policies. McWilliams carried the analogy further, noting that sports fans are eager to buy tickets, but their allegiance survives even repeated defeats. Political parties are now dominated by their passionate, sometimes insufferable, supporters. This imbalance between passions and interests has turned the Academy's decades-long defense of political parties on its head. As passion overrules interest and partisans find a sense of belonging in being with fellow travelers, even sometimes to the exclusion of an articulation of interest, or worse, the creation of a false sense of reality based on alternative facts, there arises a heretofore unthinkable situation that George Washington, in his farewell address, once envisioned, but contemporary defenders of American political parties could hardly imagine. The Democratic Party has its passionate fans, but the party retains enough diversity to articulate a series of competing interests. While Democrats are passionate about winning elections, they are equally passionate about governing. The late Mario Cuomo put it this way: "You campaign in poetry, but you govern in prose." President Joe Biden is no poet, but he is basing his re-election campaign on the prose found in the texts of legislation he has signed during his first 2 years in office. But the Republican Party has become driven by the passions and contradictory issue positions espoused by its undisputed leader, Donald J. Trump. On January 6, 2021, Donald Trump Jr. told a gathering of armed protesters in front of the White House who were preparing to storm the U.S. Capitol, "This is Donald Trump's Republican Party." His boast was not one of mere braggadocio, but a statement of fact. Virtually without precedent, no movement, save perhaps for the populace of the 1890s, has been given carte blanche by a political party. As Donald Trump's followers became overwhelmed by their sense of disenfranchisement and grievance, many gathered in Washington, D.C. Responding to Trump's call to arms, they attempted an insurrection. Addressing his loyal followers, Trump declared, "You'll never take back our country with weakness. You have to show strength, and you have to be strong." David Korn writes that Trump had engineered a distorted reality, as had all those Republicans who did not refute Trump's baseless claims about the election. Historian Ruth Ben-Ghiat maintains that Donald Trump transformed the Republican Party into an authoritarian party culture, where not only do you go after external enemies, but you go after internal enemies. You're not allowed any dissent. Ben-Ghiat believes that Trump, unlike the Democrats with their panoply of diverse interests, succeeded in imposing an authoritarian culture within the Republican Party thanks to his messaging that was almost uniformly echoed by other Republican politicians and conservative news media outlets. As a movement leader, Jessica Mersica has identified 5 rhetorical devices that Trump employed to cement the loyalties of his cult-like following. Ad hominem arguments, like his attacks on former President Barack Obama with a false claim that Obama was not born in the United States. Ad populum devices, appealing to the wisdom of the crowd, as when he praised his followers for being wiser than them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.